to give all the ingredients that will be used later to be generalized and so on. Also, I'll give today some more examples, and it will be all what I wanted to say about the geometry of the surfaces in three-dimensional space. This was some introductory part, just to give some basic notations, and so that you would have some geometrical sense, geometrical meaning of the objects that will be explained later in general relativity. So, okay. Let's remind that we have these equations. This was actually, it is easy to see that this is just formulas for this is a vector. It can be, you can find some linear combinations of the vectors R1, R2, and M such that equality holds. So this is basically simple linear algebra. When you have a frame or a basis R1, R2, and M, and you consider this linear, their linear combinations to get the vectors of the second derivatives. So this is also, we proved the Weingarten formulas. That is, how does the normality vector change and now you can consider this whole frame R1, R2, and M. Actually, if you will put it in coordinates, this will be some matrix. I don't know, F, yes? So this is some matrix F. It depends on, this matrix depends on coordinates U1, U2 that lives on our surface. And what do we want? We want to write these equations down in the following view. For example, d over dui of this matrix F is equal to what? So, here we have the first row is R1. So we have R1i, yes? And it is equal to what? Gamma 1i. Here we have 1. Here we have 2i1. And here we have 1i. Yeah? Then what we will have here? The second row is R2. Yes? 2i, 2i, 2i1, 2i2, b2i. Here we have 0. And here we have minus B I J G J 1 minus B I J G J 2. So this is some matrix, and we can write this down in the following view. Yes, so this sum matrix equality that identically holds for any surface in R3. Then what do we know? We know that if our coordinates U1 and U2, they are Descartes coordinates, so this this is trivial. Everybody knows this rule for partial derivatives. And if you will differentiate this by the, well, you see that if we can put here F, and what we will get. This equals to F, yes, and this equals to, because we have that, this equals to d over du I a j f plus a j df or the derivative of f along ui, and it equals to ai. Okay, from, and this is equals to, it is easy to understand, that is equals to d over du j ai plus so, and of course, this we will, everywhere we will have F. So, because this is a frame, yes, this is a basis, these vectors everywhere, they are linearly independent. So, this matrix has non-zero determinant, so we can multiply by F inverse, and we will get the following equations that usually called Codazzi, Gauss-Codazzi equations or null curvature equations. They are the following. So this part of the blackboard is absolutely d over du. So I'll put so as we have only two index, 1 and 2, so, and where when I equals to j, this equation is trivial, so 0 equals 0, so the only non-trivial matrix equation is the following. So everybody knows what that, yeah? Yes. Do you know? Commutator. So this is a matrix, roughly speaking, that measures how does matrix A1 and U2 commute. So this is very simple consequence of the fact that partial derivatives they are commutate. So we have this matrix equation, and what we can ask. So they called Codazzi. You may think that there are a lot of equations here because we have a 3x3 matrix, yes, and all this is some 3x3 matrix that includes some derivatives and commutators and so on. But actually, there are only three functionally independent equations here. You may think that there are nine, yeah? So we have 3x3 matrix, and for example, if you will write down the 1-1 component of this matrix, this sum matrix X, so X11, what is that? In this matrix you had d over du2 gamma 1 1 1, yes, minus d over du1 gamma 2 1 1, I think, yes. And this in commutator, what is the diagonals of the commutator? Zeros. They are all zeros because commutator is what matrix? So A1. So they are zeros. And this equals zero. Yes. So it is easy to see or know that AB minus BA for any matrix, this what will it be? It will be skew symmetric matrix. Yes. So and it always will be. The diagonals will be zeros. So, and you will have one of the equations here. This is one of its equations. But you might think that it is some non-trivial fact. But actually, it is very trivial because you have formulas for gamma ijk that equals 1/2. And so on, that describes the connection between Christoffel symbols and the first quadratic form. And it is actually, this is almost the same as the commutation of partial derivative. So nothing interesting here. But what is interesting, that here in commutator, you can see that in this matrix, you had some components that was, here you have B11, B12, for example, for A1 and 2, 1, 2, 2, yes? When you compute the commutator of these two metrics, you will finally somewhere in here you will find this. I think b11 b22 minus b12 squared. So the determinant of the second quadratic form somewhere here sits this term. And actually one of the equations that is independent and sits here is the formulation of Gauss egregium theorem that you know that, yes, that b11 b22 minus b12 squared divided by g11 22 is equal to this horrible formula, yes. This formula, it sits here. Okay, so you see that this curvature, actually, the Gaussian curvature that might be calculated through the Christoffel symbols, actually connected with formulas of this type. I want to give some generalizations of this. I'm sure that you know. For example, if you have this type of equations, so this all matrix n over n matrices, they all depends on coordinates x1, xn, yeah? And you have these equations. If I'm correct, the family of these matrices A1, AN, this called calibration field. So these definitions, they are from physics, I suppose. And you easily see that this is absolutely this case is some small situation from here. Yeah. So if you will consider all this thing, you can do the same calculations. And for example, if you had some psi depends on x, and you consider this transformation. Yes, this will be phi of x. What will be the connection between these matrices for psi and matrices for phi? It is easy to check. So of course there should be some matrices A tilde for this transformation of the psi, and it is easy to check. We'll check. So phi is dq over xi psi plus q of psi over dx is a i psi, and this is equals to a I tilde q. So we see that a tilde I equals the following thing. So this is trivial computations, but you will see that they will be generalized next. Yes. So this is formulas for a tilde. The right hand side consists of two summons. Which of them is bad?
What does it mean bad?
I don't know. Just bad, and that's all.
No. In what sense you're asking?
In algebraic sense. So you had some transformation. Psi was a matrix. You multiply this psi over some another matrix that also depends on x. What does it mean physically? Physically, it means that, for example, you rotate your system of coordinates. Yes? Obviously, you should the physical laws and all these equations should hold in this another different coordinate system. Yes? So, how does this matrix should look like? If this only a multiplication over some matrix Q. This matrix A tilde, it would be good if this summons will stay, because you see that this is only algebraic operations here. You multiply these matrices from the left and from the right side. But this term is bad because, for example, it says that if you rotate your systems in some non-trivial way, then this new matrices L tilde will depend on this rotation. Yeah. You have also the derivation here. For those who know, it means that these matrices they do not form a tensor field, because if you consider the different coordinate system, you should only this part should stay, and there should not be that part. So just remember that these matrices they do not form a tensor field. It means, for example, that Christoffel symbols also they are not tensor. It means, for example, if a tensor in a one point in zero is zero, yes, you have some tensorial field on your manifold, and in one point this tensor equals zero. What does it mean? It means that this tensor in this point in all coordinates that exist on your manifold is zero too. Yes. But here, for example, this is zero. Yes. This zero and this summand is zero, but it cannot be a zero. Yes, because it will be just another coordinate system. So this actually is not a tensor, and it is actually the same that the Christoffel symbols that defines this covariant derivative, for example, it is not a tensor too. Okay. So just remember this analogy. And what else you can consider? You can consider this thing. It is easy to see that this some analog of a curvature, actually. And actually it is called a curvature, I think. I'm not a specialist here. But these values, they are called the curvature of the calibration field. Actually, if you just forget about some exact formulas, you see that here sits some analog of Christoffel symbols, yeah? So this is a derivation of Christoffel symbols. And this is some squares of Christoffel symbols, yes? If you remember the formula for this Gaussian curvature, there was also the same kind of expressions. You had some derivation of Christoffel symbols. There was some second derivation of a metric, yes, but the first derivation of a metric, some the combination is Christoffel symbols, so you might think of this is a second derivation of a metric, and here you have some squares of Christoffel symbols. There were some parts of this type in a formula for a Gaussian curvature. So, more or less intuitively, you can think, you can agree that this type of formula is reasonable to define a curvature. And what is, by the way, what is true, that if you consider this tilde in a different coordinate system, it will be the following. I think. So there is no this part because of commutation, of course. They disappear. So it means that this object is a tensor, and it's called curvature over our calibrations. Actually, what you may think, you can consider some new derivative, and you can define it in the following way. So this is some standard derivative along the ith coordinate minus this ai. So this some differential operator, yes, and actually the following is true. So this curvature is a commutator of this covariant derivatives. So actually you can remember that how did we define the covariant derivative of a vector field on our surface. We had a vector field on a surface, we had some curve, yes. What did we do? So the formula was the following. D over dt of vector field V was equal to what? So vector field was tangent vector field, and it was equal to VI RI. This is coordinates in tangent plane. This was equal to VI plus gamma I JK. For example, VJ U dot K R I, if I'm correct. Yes? And this was the covariant derivative of a vector field on a surface along some curve. You see that this is exactly the same. That V is just vector V1, V2 in basis R1, R2. Here you have just standard derivative. This is that. And this is some shift. Yes? Here you have. So this usually in mathematics, such things, they are called affine connections. So you have some standard derivative plus some shift. And actually the commutators of this covariant derivative, it is a curvature. So standard derivative, partial derivative, they are always commute. And this shifted derivative that are usually called affine connections, they do not commute. And this measure of how exactly they do not commute, it is actually a curvature. So this is some geometrical point of view on all of these things. Basically, all this I will do all these calculations for Riemannian geometry later, but you should keep in mind all this ideology that you have some non-standard derivative on your manifold that depends on a metric of your manifold. Metric is how does you measure the length of the curves on your manifold. This dependence sits here because here you have some Christoffel symbols that sits in this matrices in this shift. And the measure of how does this extra or covariant derivatives commute is exactly the curvature. Okay. What else do I want it to say? Okay, let's do some task. Just to illustrate you once again of how complicated calculations can be in differential geometry. Okay, let's consider this type of metric. This is metric DS. So in coordinates it will be like that. I've already said this, that if you found such coordinates on your surface that its matrix looks like that, these coordinates called isothermic, I think. Isothermic coordinates. Yes?
Isothermic.
Isothermic. No. No. Isothermic. Изотермические координаты. The meaning of this if you work in Riemannian geometry, these coordinates will be called conformally Euclidean coordinates. It means that your metric, so this is 2x2 matrix, and when the dimension of your space is greater than 2, then the matrix will be like that. Yes, so this is absolutely constant matrix, and your metric depends only on a one function. So this coordinates in which the matrix looks like that, they called conformally Euclidean. So conformally is just this factor. Yes, when you multiply Euclidean absolutely flat standard from the school scalar product, if when you multiply it by this function, you get conformally Euclidean coordinates. And in you will see why does it called isothermic. You will see. Okay, let's start. So Gij is minus two lambda. This is inversed matrix. Gamma 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, E of minus 2 lambda. Yes. So here you have three summons. Because this all of indexes is equal to 1, yes. So what do you have here? You have here dg11 over the du1. U1 is x, u2 is y. So plus the same, minus the same, yeah? So this annihilates, and what do you have? You have 1 over 2 e minus 2 lambda. And here we have 2 lambda x multiplied by e 2 lambda. Yes? Because this is derivative with respect to x. So actually this is cancels and it is just lambda of x. Actually maybe I made some bad decision because it will be too long. Okay, you should calculate all six, yes, all six Christoffel symbols, and they and then we should use the Egregium theorem. Oy. Okay, G, so here we have what I equals 1, j equals 2, k equals 1, and of course l is equals 1 here too. If you just remember this formula, l equals k, so what do we have here? D g of 1, 1 over u2 plus dj 1, 2 over 1 and minus dj 1, 2 over 1. Yes? Correct me, please. You should look to this formula. I can write it down. IJK. Okay, so for example, k is equal to 1, and here actually we have a summation over the index L, yes, actually. But as j 1, 2 is 0, we forgot about the second sum and here, and consider only index L equals to 1. So, to 1. I is 1, L is 1. This is J. J is 2, L is 1. So it is always symmetric. And I is 1. So and I, J, L. Yes? I think it's correct. One over the two. Of course, we will get lambda of y. Then two to one. So L is 1, A equals, I equals J equals 2. D 2, 1, 2 plus 2, 1, 2 minus 2, 2, 1. This is 0, this is just 0, these zeros. And this is minus 2, 2 is lambda x, I think. So, actually, this is, it is all, I think. Because when you permute 1 and 2 in indexes, you permute x and y, and you permute all these indexes here, yes? So when we have a half of the Christoffel symbols, we actually already have all of them. So let me illustrate you. Gamma 2, 2, 2 equals to what? Lambda y. Gamma 2, 1, 2 equals to lambda x, and gamma 1, 1, 2 equals to minus lambda y. Okay, let's make a break, and then we should apply this Egregium theorem. Matrix of a basis, of a frame, because R1, this is R1 is R1, R2, this is the second vector in the tangent plane, so and M is a normal. So these three vectors, they form a basis, yes, of a space. Yes. And this basis, it rotates and depends on a tangent point P. So yes, and of course, all of these vectors, they depend on coordinates or on your surface. Yes. It means on U1 and U2. So you just write down all these vectors in as rows, and you get a matrix 3x3.
Ah, okay. If point goes around along some curve, for example, then these vectors is represented by basis vectors changes, but it also represented by old by basis node. No.
What do you mean by represented?
What is the matrix? Can you could you write components of the matrix? Symbolically, not concrete.
But I don't know. I wrote it symbolically. This is vector, yes?
Yes.
R1, this is vector.
Yes.
It depend. It has three coordinates. Each of them depends on variables U1 and U2. So you just, how I can illustrate you? I thought it was easy. For example, we have sphere, yes? X yes. So X is actually is depends on two variables.
Yes.
This is U1 and this is U2. And I can write this down, yeah? So actually this, all this vector is vector R that depends, that is three-dimensional and depends on two variables.
Yes, yes.
So R1 is just dr over du1, yes. And it is equals to just find the derivative of this vector. So this is absolutely, now it's absolutely explicit. So you can find this derivative. Yes?
Yeah.
And you have some coordinates. So this is x prime on over u1, y prime over u1, z prime over u1. This is r1. You calculate it for some examples, you can do it explicitly. And you get this vector, and you write them down.
Okay.
You have three coordinates here. X prime u1, y prime u1, z prime u1. Here you have x prime u2, y prime u2, z prime u2. And here you have the vector product of these two vectors.
Normal.
Yes. How can you get the normal? You should calculate the vector product and normalize. So this is a matrix. This is a matrix, and as this matrix consists of three linearly independent vectors, it is non-degenerate. So you can consider this is, I don't know. When you consider this type of equation, it is okay for you that x is a vector, yes?
Yeah.
Why couldn't you consider x as a matrix?
Okay.
So this is will be a matrix, this is matrix, this matrix, it is almost the same. Okay, now we should write all this down. Ой, неправильно. Так, 1, 1, это минус лямбда по y. 2, 1, это лямбда по x. А 2, 2, 2. Окей. Окей, гауссиан curvature. So one over the determinant of the first quadratic form, this is g11 multiplied by g22, and this is equal to e in the power of 4 lambda. Then I always forget. So g11 is e to the power of 2 lambda. So this is k equals 1, l equals 1. Gamma 1 to 1, 1 to 1, 1 to 1. This is lambda squared. Please check, I use this formula from the third lecture, and if I'll put something wrong, it will be disaster. Так. So here the second summand is when k equals 2, l equals 2. And here we have 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2. This is lambda x squared minus 1, 1, 2. 1, 1, 2 is plus, and 2, 2. I think this is true. Plus 1, 2 is 0, so minus, one half. Second derivative of g11 by the second variable. The first derivative by the second variable is d over the dy. The first derivative is Yes, so this is the first derivative of g11 over the second variable. Doesn't matter. Okay. So the second derivative will be, this is of course 4 lambda y squared plus 4. So what we will have here, because there will be also a second derivative over the first variable of g22, we will have the following. So this is of course will be out of the bracket, here we have 4 lambda y squared plus 4 lambda x squared plus 2 lambda xx plus 2 lambda yy. And all of that is cancelled. And we will have 2 here was minus 1/2 minus this minus 1/2 and these 2 cancels. Laplacian of lambda divided by e to the power of 2 lambda.
Does it cancel e to the power 2 lambda and e to the minus?
What? E 2 lambda, 4 lambda. So finally we get this, of course these coordinates, they are very good, they are very useful. We have that our curvature is some kind of Laplacian, yes, in good coordinates. It means that in some different coordinates it also will be a Laplacian, but some perturbated Laplacian, but still. It means that this curvature is elliptic operator of the metric. It is important. For example, maybe someone heard about this Perelman proof of the Poincaré conjecture, yes, and he used this type of equality. Well, this is called minus rich. So this is some kind of also a curvature, some combination of some curvatures. Ij, sometimes they put here 2. But still you can see that this is some kind of parabolic equation, yes, some kind of heat equation. It is very generalized, and actually it is highly non-linear equation, because if you consider the sum of 2 matrix, the right hand side won't be a sum of this, because this part is very non-linear. But still this asymptotic or qualitative behavior of these equations is in some sense is like the solutions for the heat equation. And eventually when you do some manipulations, you can prove the behavior of this matrix. So of course this is very very non-trivial result, but it is eventually deals with the behavior of the solutions for the heat equation. I've tried to read Perelman papers. There are 3 of them on archive. You know archive? Yes. They are very hard to understand. But it was about 5 years ago. Maybe now I'll try once again. Okay. So what I wanted to say more about that. So about this basic variational principle ideology. How did we get the equations for the geodesics on a surface? We consider some functional that was actually a length, yes? And we vary our curve and state that this functional should be minimum on that curve. It means that actually this variation of that functional should be zero. Yes, on that curve, if that curve is the shortest one. And eventually we get geodesic equations. I want you to illustrate that this is ideology is really, really general. I think that one of the main ideas in physics is to find the Lagrangian. When you find some good Lagrangian, you think that everything is done. But in geometry also, you can variate not only a curve, but you can variate a surface itself. For example, you have some surface and you can consider its deformation. Yeah? What functional should you consider here? What is more, the most logical functional?
Area,
of course. You consider the area. The area of this surface. It is calculated like that. du1, du2. So, do you understand why should we put this here? Yes? Okay, it's good. Okay, and this integral, this is double integral, yeah? And this absolutely the same ideology here. You consider this as a functional of on the infinitely dimensional space of all surfaces, yeah? And you want your surface to be the minimal, to be the minimizer of that functional, yeah? So on your surface, that functional should have some minimum. Of course, you variate it, and then you get this equation. The mean curvature of your surface should be zero. Actually, this is minimal surfaces. It is really hard to construct because when I wrote this down, you actually don't understand how difficult to solve this equation because you have this sum of two principal curvatures, and when you write this down, it will be highly nonlinear differential equation in partial derivatives, and to construct some new example of minimal surfaces is really a challenge. There is a great list of examples for the minimal surfaces that are known at present time, but to construct some new example, especially in some explicit formulas, it is really a challenge for geometricians. So this is, although the ideology is really straight and simple, and you understand everything to construct a really good new example, it's really hard, really. So, for example, in our chair, there is a guy. So not in our chair. He works in Yakutsk. Shamaev Ali. So this is guy, he lives in Yakutsk. Do you know where is it? It is even more colder than here. So to the north. There are a lot of diamonds there. Probably you've heard about this place. So dissertation to get PhD here was about construction of minimal surfaces. So this is up until now. It's all techniques on all science. It is alive, and there are a lot of scientists who tries to find new solutions for these equations. So this, yes.
What is H?
Mean curvature. So H is K1 plus K2 divided by 2. K1 and K2, it is solutions for this equation. Okay. So now I want just to summarize all the main facts that I've presented during first five lectures, and you should keep this all these ingredients in mind, and then we will go next. So metric. This is the main object, and the main object we want to find to with some good properties. Metric is a you can, this is JJ. I put here N because we will have actually four-dimensional time space. You can think of it as a scalar product in a tangent space of your manifold. Then what else you should remember about Gaussian curvature K that was defined as a determinant of second by the determinant of the first quadratic form, but as a Gregium theorem is true. This object can be described only in the terms of this first quadratic form. And this is very important because you should not think of some manifold to be curved, and you should not think of this. If you have some curved manifold, you should not think that this manifold lies in some bigger space. You should just calculate some length, some tensors, and it is enough. We shouldn't imagine that how should it looks like, it doesn't matter. So this is principal moment. Then there is a covariant derivative. And actually this curvature is a commutation of covariant derivatives, actually, although it was defined as a projection on a tangent plane of standard derivative. Yes, when I calculated this derivative, there was a part with m, with normal, yes, and to get the covariant derivative, we cancelled this summand with a normal, so we just projectivize our derivative of a vector field on the tangent plane. So we just forgot about anything that doesn't live in our surface. But also, you might think that this covariant derivative also depends on something that lies outside of our space. Also, this can be calculated with something that depends only on a metric also. And this Gaussian curvature is a commutator of covariant derivatives, which is also depends on a first quadratic form. And this covariant derivative, you should think of it. This is only annotation, just for you to think that these objects more or less are the same. So covariant derivative, connection, it is usually equals in some dots. It is usually looks like something standard derivative plus some shift that depends on something. Just to keep in mind some formulas. Derivative. So yeah, about Gaussian curvature, you should remember this theorem agregium. And that curvature is elliptic differential operator of second order over metric. So this is, of course, very roughly speaking, but to get the idea. Okay, and this ideology, variational principle. So, and that you have some reasonable functional that you have in mind and you think that is reasonable, and you get Euler-Lagrange equations. So this is probably this is all what is you should understand, and then we will go. I'll present some basic theorems about tensorial calculus, and then we will go to this general relativity. Yes, and about spinners, I found some old and very geometrical book. Probably I'll do one or two lectures about spinners and about group representations about this. There is some what? Нет. Эли Картан. So actually I began to read this book, and this is was nice, really. So Cartan, he was really so his language is really unique. So he, some of his calculations are really trivial, and in another he put something down and you just don't understand without some your calculations. But still there are some funny identities and formulas that I think will be useful for you, and about Lie groups representations, some this stuff, and actually this is very old, 1947, and it is in Russian, but it is absolutely readable for geometricians, because when mathematicians began to read some book about quantum physics, it's really, really not the different language, I would say. Okay, next time, I don't know what exactly will be, whether I will start with tensoria or with the spinors, and the time after next I will be in different city in Kazan, so there will be a pause, and then we'll discuss about this gap. Okay.